When it all goes wrong, the fires, they keep burning on. Well, I'll hold myself together. Welcome to Threes of Social.
Today we'll be speaking to Yado Mambo, the man himself.
It's going to be a big interview. All I'm saying is we're going to find real insights into the life of a footballer, how it is growing up in the academy, and life after football. Check it out.
Today we're joined by a special guest, a very special guest. This guest has played for teams such as Charlton, Shrewsbury, AFC Wimbledon, Ebbsfleet, the list goes on. He's won trophies on top of that, accolades to go with it. He's played in FA Cups for AFC Wimbledon against MK Dons. This man needs no introduction. No introduction, sorry. I started there. That's how nervous I am when it comes to meeting legends such as...
I should have got a trim. Sorry about that. My bub's in Senegal right now.
That's me. We're all feeling that pain.
It's gone for 3 weeks. 3 weeks.
By Yado Mambo.
Thank you for having me, guys.
It's big. Thank you very much for taking the time to come and see us, man.
Pleasure.
Well, first of all, welcome to Threes of Social.
Come on.
But more than anything, let's get straight into it. I want to find out more about you.
Cool.
And how this all began for you. But let's take it back to your childhood, mainly.
Childhood?
And football. How that intertwines.
Growing up, obviously, in South Coburn, football's a big part of my life back then. Obviously, as you know, Pan and Rec used to go there like, most days.
Yes.
The victory lap.
The stumping ground. Yeah,
that's
so
it.
I've been there most days on podium, just playing. Everyone's football rotated. Everything. Mm-hmm. Watching football, everyone around was playing football. So that's when my love for football became.
A favourite football team at that point?
To be fair, it was torn between two. Because obviously one of my neighbours, Irish guy called Stephen Barrett, right? He used to support West Ham. And tickets were for £1. We used to call kid for £1. So we used to go most games and watch the games, and I ended up getting a shirt. Never thought for West Ham.
No one knew who this guy supported.
No, like, wanted to ask no, no one knows. But
it's like what's the boxer's name? Till this day!
Nah, but I do love Arsenal. I don't really shy it like I should, but
why is that?
I want to say they're dead, but you know, I don't really shy out. But I'm very neutral when it comes to football teams. I love football teams and that, so don't really have a preference.
Seem to insult Liverpool quite a bit, but
no, only because of you, if I'm honest.
Fair enough.
But Liverpool are a great team, but in terms of me getting into football, I was a late bloomer. That's what I'd say. Obviously, going to secondary school. I played football in primary school.
Okay.
Obviously, for the local, obviously, for the school team.
Yeah.
To be fair, I was a striker.
Back in the days.
Okay. Yeah. Only my teacher in year six was like, you know what, I think you'd be better as a defender.
Okay.
I said, why? I scored all the goals. Yeah. I said, why? Yeah. He said, no. I think you'll be better as a centre back. I said, why? Because I'm tall.
Yeah.
He said, I just think you've got a knack for defending.
Okay.
I gave it a go.
Yeah.
You know what? I kind of liked it. I said, you know what? No one's actually getting past me. So
monster at the back.
Yeah, it felt nice. Mm. And then obviously, at the time, I was like year four, playing for the year sixes. And then I went to secondary school. That's when the ball started rolling.
Okay.
I wasn't aware of how big football could be for me.
So can I ask, like, what was it your dream to get into football when you transitioned into secondary school, obviously playing more?
It wasn't.
Okay.
I never thought about, not once, being a professional footballer.
So you're just playing for the fun of it, basically?
Just for the fun.
Yeah. Okay, okay.
As you know, people in the academy nowadays, they start off at like 6 or 7, they're already homegrown in the academies. I had no idea.
Yeah.
So I signed for my first team, a local team called Kensington Dragons, in Ladbroke Grove. Big up Kensington Dragons, by the way. A couple of my guys in my year played for the team and said, oh, come down, do you fancy it? I said, why not? So I went down there, tried it out, got signed. I played about 6 games, but I was lucky. I'll tell you why I was lucky, because our goalkeeper, also my friend Charlie Carpenter, good friend of mine, his dad was a Charlton scout.
Okay.
Yeah, so he'd come and watch Charlie school games and play the Dragon games, right? Because, I kind of like this dude. Like, who is he? So after 6 games playing for the Dragons, he gave me his card. He said, you know what, come down to Charlton.
It only took
six games.
That's right. How old is it at this time?
I was 12.
Okay.
12 going on 13.
Yeah.
So I was thinking, okay, so I told my dad, look, I got this card for Charlotte Flick. Mm. Didn't know who they were at the time. I was not aware. Obviously, you knew about the Chelsea,
the big team.
But I didn't know about Charlton.
Yeah.
I didn't know how big the actual scale of this was until when I first went there.
Yeah. For real.
It was a culture shock.
Mm-hmm.
I won't even lie. It was massive. I went there for my first day at Charlton. I went there. Huge. The complex was huge. Mm. Also, I'm used to St. Mark's Park.
Mm-hmm.
One small thing, one pitch
behind the main park.
One little changing room, four cabin, three benches, and that's it.
They had it all, man.
Yeah.
It was a different level. And I said, wow. And the caliber of the players I was playing with, I won't lie, I was very, very scared and very nervous.
Yeah.
And then from then, I don't know, just, I thought, you know what, this is what I want to be. Yeah.
So, If I could take you back to school, obviously, 12, 13, you've now been scouted by Charlton and you're playing at the academy.
Yeah.
How did that affect you thinking about school then? Because obviously, knowing a lot of footballers, they tend to put school on the back burners because obviously now they're interested in making it as a footballer. Mm. How was that for you?
That's a good one, actually, to be fair, because when I was in school after getting signed from Charlton, I thought, you know what, do I need school?
Ready to be here, sort of.
Do I need to be here? I messed about a bit more in school. It was this fact, like, I felt untouchable at the same time because I knew how good I was at football.
Yeah.
In terms of all the other students in my fellow peers in my year.
Mm.
So I thought, you know what, I don't need school, I got football.
Mm-hmm.
And I slightly regret that, if I'm honest. I still think I should touch school a bit more serious than I did.
Yeah.
When you say that, do you mean like secondary school?
Secondary school.
That setting?
That whole secondary school, year 7 to...
Why did you feel that though? Did you just think that I'm going to be a footballer? So
that's all I knew. I was very tunnel visioned.
Yeah.
So once I was on the ladder to become a footballer,
mm-hmm.
I thought, you know, this is it. Like, I'm playing for a professional team here.
Yeah, but the thing is, it's understandable though, because if I was like, for example, like good at, I don't know, maths, for example, I'm a run with that, do you know what I mean?
Exactly.
And not focus so much on English, for example, do you know what I mean?
And if you're playing for a professional team at such a young age, and all your fellow peers are looking up to you, and even the teachers at some point, like, oh, you know what, you're actually going to do your thing.
Did you get preferential treatment from the teachers?
Nah, to be fair, one of my head of year was a bit against me at the time.
Mm.
I never knew why.
Mm. Okay.
It was always a threat. If I was doing something wrong, I'm gonna call your team. I'm gonna call your football team, and not you're not gonna go far. I'm thinking, well, what's that about?
Yeah,
you know what I mean.
Yeah.
Wrong approach.
Yeah. So
maybe he didn't want to see you succeed in that way.
Maybe not.
Why would you threaten
that? I don't even think it's that. You know, maybe it's a thing where he wanted you to succeed, so he wanted to use that as do your studies, or I won't get you. Yeah. I won't have to speak to your school.
Yeah. Because I'm playing for Charlton Athletic, we had a day release.
Mm.
So I'd miss school for a couple of days to go train.
Mm.
And I was hardly in school. It felt like I was never in school.
Yeah. Okay.
So I come back to school thinking, oh, I don't remember learning this.
Did your school not give you stuff to do?
They gave me homework and stuff, but come on, I got thrown on the floor of my bag.
You missed out on a lot then?
Yeah, so like in terms of obviously doing PE for GCSEs, I mostly got the theory side apart from the physical side, right? Mm. Obviously, doing the whole physical side, obviously the football and all that, I was there. But for the theory side, learning about the bones and the muscles and that, I was never there.
Okay.
So I never actually grasped that side of that, that study. So it was just like, you know what I mean? Like, I didn't really care. Like, I had football, so tunnel vision, thinking, football, I don't really care about this. Football's my goal, you know what I mean?
Okay, yeah.
And it was, I do regret, I won't lie, I do regret. I think I should actually study. I should have made myself got out of my way to make sure I study them.
Do you feel like academy should be working with students that are in secondary school to make sure that they are still doing their studies? Because obviously nowadays there are a lot of footballers that don't get past to sign the academy papers.
Yeah.
And now they're looking for a job.
Yeah, because there's a structure in obviously in terms of academy football. Obviously after 16 you get given a scholarship.
Yeah.
So a scholarship is 2 years, basically from 16 to 18 to see whether you're good enough to get a professional contract, right? So, but not everyone gets that scholarship.
Yeah.
And I feel football clubs should highlight more that, listen, if you don't get this, you have to fall back on something.
Yes, 100%.
Do you know what I mean? I.e. go to sixth form or go to a college to learn something.
But don't you think that should be implemented through the academy phase? Like through
the I agree. I feel that the academy should do more.
Yeah.
To tell the kids, listen, you're just not guaranteed that you're gonna get a contract, even a pro contract, even a scholarship, it's not guaranteed.
For real, yeah, for real.
Yeah. But we're always taught as young men in the academy world that football, it has to be your
bread and butter.
Bread and butter, yeah. Food and drink, that's all you have to know.
Mm.
You know what I mean? So you forget about the other side of reality. Mm. You're too focused on just that thing, just to get that contract.
That's interesting. So you feel like you were taken away from...
I felt like I was in a bubble.
Okay.
In some sort. Okay.
Sorry to interrupt.
That's fine.
Just a quick question. In terms of, you said, you know, GCSEs.
Mm.
Did you get any GCSEs then? And how did it affect you?
I got, I think I got 6 or 7 GCSEs. Mm. I can't remember what I got in specifically, but I know I got 6 or 7.
Mm.
I feel if I did not done more, I could have got more.
Mm.
If I pushed myself, I could have got a bit more. But like I said, I wasn't even focused about that.
Yeah.
As long as I got above 5,
yeah,
you're good to go. Yeah, good to go. So I didn't think about that. Once I got the 6 or 7, cool. Year 11's done. Full time form.
Yeah.
Straight away. Even moved house.
Yeah. I used to, funny enough, I used to see you and obviously your dad. I knew your dad pushed you very hard at football.
Yeah, he did.
I used to see Yado walking with his dad with his Charlton kit, and he's like, yeah, just going to train with my dad. Yeah. And he looked happy.
Happy, yeah.
It was a great time. I won't lie. Obviously, you finish in school.
Yeah.
You rush home to the number 6 bus back to my house,
for real.
South Cooblin. Go home, get changed quick. My dad will come, whistle downstairs. I'm here now. Go down, get a train. My dad sacrificed quite a lot for me to.
So you speak about your dad. In terms of your parents, what impact and what support did you get from your parents? You know, being that young, going into academies, trying to make it as a footballer.
And let me add on to that, especially with your parents being African as well.
Mm.
Especially with how Africans focus on education.
Do you know what? I think my parents are both novice in terms of the whole football.
Yeah.
The whole academy. They didn't know.
Mm.
They knew obviously the whole Premier League and stuff, but they didn't know the ins and outs of the actual academy football.
Mm-hmm.
And I think me and my parents both got educated at the same time.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Do you make sense? But they support me massively. Especially my dad. Mum was there, mum made sacrifices, but the one I saw with me at the time was my dad.
Yeah.
My dad changed shifts at his job just so he can take me to football.
Yeah.
He used to work night shifts so he can be free during the day to take me to football.
Wow.
Even not just the academy football, even my Cousins and Dragons, dad was always there.
Did you feel a lot of pressure at that time?
From my dad?
Did you feel pressure?
No. Not at the time from my dad anyway. My dad always said to me, just play your game.
That's it.
He said, just play your game. But I didn't feel pressure until I reached about the age of, I'd say after going into football full time, that's when the pressure starts to fall.
And then how old were you when you went full time?
16.
That's crazy, man. 16. You know, I can relate to that story because I remember when, I was trying to make it as a footballer as well, you know what I'm saying? I was trying.
As we all, man, you know as we all do.
We all had that dream. And I remember when my mum took me to a trial, I think it was to get into QPR, took me to a trial and we went into the office, we spoke to the guy, and the guy was like, look, I think your son is good, but he's too short. True stories. He said, your son's too short. And then after that, my mum was like, enough of the football. We've given it a go.
You're going to
focus on your studies.
My
mum pulled me out straight away.
Mm-hmm.
And now I'm thinking, could I have gone on?
Yeah. You know? How does that make you feel, though? Like, do you feel like you were not capable to play football, play your games, or anything?
Yeah, I don't know. It made me feel like, you know, shit, basically. Like,
it feels like, oh yeah, like,
yeah,
okay, that's enough now.
That's enough now.
Your chance is gone, basically.
Yeah.
But that goes back to African parents.
Exactly. Really,
because they care more about education. That's what gets drilled into you.
And that's the annoying bit about African parents. They need to understand that this is the opportunity to change lives.
Yeah.
Like that is more outside of education.
If your son or daughter has a gift, it could be football, could be music, could be anything.
Could be anything.
Let them hone their craft.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then your life could change, potentially.
Yeah. Exactly.
You know, education is not everything.
Yeah, of course.
So look at Alan Sugar. Did you go to college? Did you go uni? No.
Yeah.
Look at him now.
Exactly.
You know what I mean? So I think they need to understand a bit more. That they need to let their children hone their craft.
So obviously moving into full-time football and that, obviously us lots started coming to watch you play football, playing FA Youth Cup and things like that. How was that full transition? I know you said there was more pressure.
It was a big transition.
Were you more focused on making it now? Like, yo, I'm ready, I'm here. I'm
close to a professional contract. I was, because obviously when I got the scholarship, I moved house.
Yeah.
I moved to Kent for 2-3 years. and it was just different, man. Yeah. I had no family around. Wow. I had no friends. Mm. I had my teammates I lived with, but that's different, do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But that 2 years that I was down there, it was intense, man. Mm. Okay. It was a very, very intense. Like, the training regimes we do every day was just full on.
Football.
You have college. Yeah. Once a week or so, but no one took that serious.
Yeah.
For like MBQs, that sports science, all that stuff. Mm-hmm. Like, no one wanted to do, but we had to do it as part of the protocol.
Yeah.
Coaching, to do that as well, to get your badges. But apart from that, football. But the thing is, it's intense, but it's such a great place to be, man.
Mm.
Like, I thoroughly enjoyed my time. It's just, I can't even describe how good it is. Mm. I think any guy that's been through academy process, they can tell the same. Like, it's just amazing. The things you learn, the people you meet. The countries you tour, the teams you play, the people you play in front, people you play get like in front of, scoring a goal, like it's just nice, man. Different coaches that you meet, like obviously football's obviously a high turnover in football, so you meet people come and go.
Of course.
And you make good friends. I've made a lot of good friends in football over these years, and it's just a great place, man.
Yeah, it's a great
place, honestly.
So all right, so you're at Charlton.
Yes.
Tell us about your time at Charlton. So you say that you felt like you were gonna basically, this is it now.
Mm.
I'm gonna make it. Was that what was going through your mind?
That didn't happen.
Who were you playing with? Like what kind of players? Because you know, name drop, man.
You know what? That whole thinking of me thinking, oh, I'm gonna make it didn't happen until I played at the FA Youth Cup.
Okay.
I was actually 16, so I wasn't actually a scholar yet.
Yeah.
And also FA Youth Cup's for first year and second year scholars. And me and Jonjo Shelby plays for Newcastle right now in Premier League.
Come on.
We was the only two from the R-Rays to play up for the big boys.
Wow.
And I thought, you know what, this could be it, you know. Mm. My dad said to me, listen, you're playing up, playing really well.
Mm.
Like we got to the quarterfinals.
Yeah.
And we was playing well. Destroying teams, left, right, centre. Destroying teams.
Jeez.
You know, like I was on standby for England.
Rawr.
I could have played for Congo. I said, nah, let me wait for England. That's just the pinnacle.
That's of course.
My age group, the players on that roster was just unbelievable. And to be on standby was wow.
It's an accolade in itself.
You know what I mean? It's a great accolade. So I thought, you know what, let me wait. So, and then when I started getting interest from other teams from playing the Youth Cup, I thought, you know what, if other teams are interested, this must be something. I'm doing something right.
Yeah.
So I had Newcastle sniffing around, I had Reading, I had Arsenal. But obviously, when I spoke to my dad about it, he just said to me, listen, stay here. Because at the time, Cho was in the Premier League.
Yeah.
You know? He goes, this will be an easy route for you to get into the Premier League.
It's true.
I said, cool.
Mm.
At the time, I was thinking, Arsenal would be bloody juicy. Nice,
yeah.
It would be massive. Imagine me playing for Arsenal. Come on, that's a big thing. But Cho was not, it's not a small team, it's a big club.
Yeah, a lot of major names have made it from
Cho. A lot of huge names have made it from Cho. So I said, cool. Stayed at Charlton and then progressed. And then when I made another jump, also got my scholarship, then I made my debut at 17.
Yeah.
I thought this is a show that I want to stay on forever.
That's it.
It's beautiful playing in front of the crowds and everything.
I played a competition called the Johnston Pate Trophy.
Yeah.
We played against Barnet. They had like Yannick Bolasie playing, Albert Adoma playing, like they had big players playing.
Name drop, come on.
I think I came on 75th minute.
Yeah.
I replaced someone called Kelly Hugo at the time, one left back, French guy, good guy. And then I was kind of nervous, but I thought, you know what, just take it my stride. Yeah. And then obviously the first header that came just banged like a big, big, big header. I thought, you know what, this is it, let's go. And then I was settled, won 4-0. I felt great.
Yeah.
And then, do you know what I mean? But things like that are highs, then they can be lows.
Yeah.
Mm. So after that high, I didn't play first team for quite a while.
So, okay, so talk us through that. Then.
Yeah.
Talk us through how, obviously, the weight, the patience.
It's a funny thing, because when you're there, when you have a little sniff, you want to stay there.
Mm.
And because I was so young making my debut, and obviously it's a competition that no one even cares about, so it's a chance for you team players to get some minutes. I still wanted to be there.
Yeah.
It was very annoying waiting around. Obviously, you trained the first team, cool.
Yeah.
But at the same time, I felt like a human mannequin at times. Just watch numbers, you know? I feel like, I'm training these guys every day, but nothing's really cracking.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Then you start to think, what's wrong? Do I need to work on something?
Yeah.
Did you speak to like the coach about that?
You speak to coaches, but I have no right to tell him because I'm 17, 18, training the first team.
Yeah.
Not many people do that, you know what I mean?
Mm.
Mm. And I can't, and obviously they've got their first team and they're in the league doing really well. So I can't really go up to the gaffer and say, listen, I deserve to play.
Yeah.
I couldn't do that. No chance. Crazy.
But you were highly regarded, of course.
I was highly regarded, but at the same time, there's players of a high caliber above me. So it's very difficult. You can call it as a high rank.
Yeah.
But
So you hit the pinnacle, came on as a sub. Tell me where it went all wrong. Like
it went all wrong later down the line. This is after Left Charlton.
This is after you.
This is way after Left Charlton. This is when it started to go downhill.
Okay.
Shall we jump into that?
So talk us through your, obviously we put in front of you a few of the clubs that you've played for, and the loan spells that you've been on, obviously whilst you're at Charlton. Which one stands out to you the most? Which team had the biggest impact on Yado Mambo's career and made you believe again? Because obviously...
So obviously seeing this list here, obviously the first four or five, I say, are lower league teams, right? So this is when I was 17, 18. Just going out to get some men football, get some minutes. Cool. And then when I got the call, I remember this like yesterday, I was on the way to a reserve game. To play, he was playing Swansea at the time. My manager at the time said, "Yeah, come to the front of the coach." I went to the front of the coach. Like, "Oh, what's up?" He goes, "Oh, I'm just had a phone call. You're gonna go on loan." I said, "To where?" He goes, "Oh, Dagenham Redbridge," and they're League Two at the time. I said, "Ah, perfect. I'm buzzing. Yeah. Go to the back. See, man, I'm going. Nah, I'm going.
See you later. Okay.
Peace be on
you. Man, we'll be in touch. I'm Oskies.
Oh yeah.
So." Then he called me again, he goes, "Oh, sorry, it's AFC Wimbledon." I said, "Oh, even better."
"Man, them, definitely out." "You might not see me again."
I went back to "Man, them, mistake." "It's AFC Wimbledon, by the way."
Yeah.
Everyone's buzzing for me.
Yeah.
I said, "Cool." So I got off the coach, got a taxi back, and I played that evening. Played Oxford United in the night game, in the League Two game.
Yeah.
Nervous as hell. This is a league game.
Yeah.
So I ain't played the league before. Rang my dad, said, "Dad, big man, I've got a call."
"Come on."
He said, "Where? Where, when, what time?" I said, 7:45 kickoff, Oxford, the Kasim Stadium. Be there. Yes. He said, "Cool, I'll be there."
Beautiful.
I went there, met the team, nervous. "Hello everyone, how are you?" Met at a hotel, introduced myself and whatnot. And then remember walking in around, thinking, "Oh, this is it, you know, this is actually a big game. Like, there'll be highlights on Sky Sports News." See myself running on the screen. Do you know what I mean? Like, all these things went into my mind. But at the same time, I was really nervous. I was thinking, I can't make no mistakes here.
Yeah.
But being my first game, I'm allowed a mistake or two. Do you know what I mean? I'm learning. We played the game. We drew 3-3. I had a good game. I should have, but he scored. If I scored, I'm not icing the cake. We drew 3-3. And I thought, this is nice. I can actually do this.
Yeah.
You know? Ringing my friends back at Chelsea, listen, this is actually a good feeling, boys.
Yeah.
Like, this is actually one that I think we all should taste.
Yeah.
And then that was sick. And then I had a good time. Obviously, AFC Wimbledon and MK Dons were once a one club together, right? And then we played, we got them, drew them in the FA Cup. That was massive. Huge. Huge game. The coverage, we had that the whole week. Interviews, ITV, BBC, Sky Sports News, the game was on TV. Everything was just like, you know what? This is a massive game.
I'm not gonna lie, we were gassed when we heard. Every time I wanted to tune in, it was every man sick. Yeah, was playing. Man, them Sky Sports.
Circulating.
It went around town, man. Like,
and how did that make you feel, though?
It was amazing. I had like school friends texting, calling me, family, people in the neighborhood in Kilburn, South Kilburn. Yeah, I was like, "Oh yeah, you're on TV, I got you still. Cool." Play that game, and I won't lie, I had one of the greatest games probably ever.
You played really well, and you nearly scored in the last minute.
So
I remember that.
To win the game. Playing against Alan Smith, you know Alan Smith, ex-Leeds.
Name drop, come on.
he shook my hand after the game and said, "You're going to go places."
Swear.
The commentators were saying that about you. They were saying, "Yado Mambo is going far.
Yeah,
watch out for this guy."
I got told by a few people. They said,
no word of a lie, goosebumps, man.
After Alan Smith, he's obviously... He's high profile.
X-Man
United as well.
X-Man U, X-Leeds, come on, big strike in the game. And when he came to me, he said, "You're going to go far." I saw that picture of me and him shaking hands.
I said,
"That's just thank you very much." Totally humbled. I felt great. I said, cool. And that same day, we went back. We had a game postponed during midweek. I got a phone call from Chris Powell, my channel manager. I said, "Listen, Shrewsbury Town want you." I said, "Oh." I didn't know nothing about Shrewsbury Town at the time.
Yeah.
They're a league above. I said, "Oh, wow." But it's far. also my first time traveling very, very far. Well, past Wolverhampton, bro, it's far.
Wow.
Far, 3 hours drive, yeah, middle of nowhere. Mm. There was no black people there.
It was a bit uncomfortable.
There's horses running around by the top, no owners. Horses galloping, no owners.
Used to message me, said, please come down.
Somebody, I'm coming back, man. I'm coming today, yeah. We said, got to get tomorrow, but it's cool, I'm coming.
Somebody just come see me. I was in the hotel for time.
Yeah.
I tried to get my apartment sorted out, but it never got sorted out. Mm. I was in the hotel for about 3-4 months. Wow. Holiday Inn. It was terrible. It was the worst time ever. But on the flip side, the football was amazing.
Yeah.
It was sick. I had a great, great time. And I was playing very well.
Yeah.
At this point, I'm thinking, nothing can stop me here. Come on. Nothing's going to stop me here.
Yeah.
So I was there from January to about, say, April.
Mm.
Went to Charlton, thinking, all right, cool, I'll get a new deal.
Yeah.
I was very, very adamant I was getting a new deal. Yeah. Walking around the training ground, everyone was like, oh, yeah, you found out today, get a new deal, right? Mm. Yeah, everyone was like, you'll be fine, man. You'll get listed up. Cool. So they played against Bristol City, right? The last game of the championship season, right?
Mm.
Bristol City have been relegated. We're not going up or down.
Yeah.
This is the perfect time to, I thought he'll fling in the youth. Just have a little taste, a little sniff.
Yeah.
I wasn't in the squad. I was like, this doesn't really make sense. Went back to change, I called my dad. I said, something's not right here. He says I'm not in the squad, and I don't know why. He said, go ask him. I said, okay. When I slammed the door, I said, Gaffer, can I have a word, please? He said, cool. I said, Why am I not in the squad?
Yeah.
He said, oh, I have other people to think about. First of all, I need games. I said, Gaffer, no disrespect, but it's the last game of the season.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think no one really cares. Everyone's going on holiday right now.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? For me, I want to play. At least involve me.
Yeah.
If I was involved and not play, cool.
Were you on the squad?
I wasn't in the squad.
Bro.
I wasn't even in the squad. So that really hurt me. Because I thought, I don't know. Out of all the low knees, I done the best. I played the highest.
Yeah.
I played the most games.
So you had the best numbers.
I had the best numbers.
Statistics on your side.
Numbers don't lie. And then a week later, on the office again to find out if I get a new deal or not. He told me no.
Wow. So, all right. Tell us more about the loan spell, because I read somewhere on a BBC article that at the end of every summer, footballers, like young youth players, they're under immense pressure. Mm-hmm. And they're scared, that fear of uncertainty of not making it. And they said that the stats is 700 young, kids.
That's the big fear.
And nothing happens.
Football is pros and cons. There's a lot of pros and cons of football. The pros, amazing, but the cons, very daunting. If you don't get a team, say you're a free agent, your phone might not ring.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
When I got released from Charlton,
yeah.
After having that sick loan spot at AS Wimbledon and Shrewsbury, my phone, I think, something right, my phone didn't ring. Did my phone ring once? It did not ring.
But why is that though? Considering your stats,
I honestly couldn't tell you. I ring my agent, I said, yo, like, what's going on? He told me, oh, just be patient. I said, I don't have time to be patient.
Yeah.
And then I want to get the ball rolling.
Yeah.
Find my team, go on holiday, come back, know where I'm going to be. So he told me to relax, calm down. Yeah. I ended up getting rid of him.
Raw. So it's not like how we do our jobs where we go hand in our CVs. Mm. What do footballers do? Like, do they hire an agent?
Footballers have agents.
Yeah.
And they represent you where they talk to clubs for you. Or clubs talk to agent about you.
Mm.
Yeah. Right? Well, some clubs can talk to you directly.
Mm.
It's up to you. But I had the agent to represent me to tell me, okay, who's interested, where I could go, possibilities of what trials they can have, what contract I can get, how much money I could earn, how much appearance fee I can get.
Mm.
There's a lot behind the scenes that nobody actually realised.
How do you go about like kind of getting an agent or picking an agent?
Agents approach you.
Okay.
Okay.
Oh, fair.
Agents watch all games and they approach you. Mm. So it's up to you. You can have 10 on the table. It's up to you to pick.
Oh, fair.
So
what goes through the decision making process to find a right agent? Just so the young guys out there can know.
Nowadays, I feel that kids go off agent due to reputation.
Okay.
Mm. And name of the agency.
Mm.
Some agencies can be massive in the game and have so many players on their roster.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But they won't care about the players, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
You can go to a small agency, they don't have as much players, but individual players get love and attention personally.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Which is nice, which I feel is the best way. I feel that relationship with agencies and players these days is not really the greatest. Agents, sometimes it's all about the money. They say they're not, but I feel that they are.
Mm.
If you're under an agency, they've got a lot of players on their list, you won't get that attention that you need.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
you will be felt like you're in the dark.
Mm-hmm.
And you've got to do things yourself. So it's, I'd say the kids, if you have the agency, the agent that has time for you, mm-hmm. that calls you, comes to your games, and just make sure you're all right after you work. Never mind about the football. Family,
yeah,
just the whole mm-hmm. your whole life experience.
Yeah.
Then that's the perfect agency to go for. Mm-hmm. Just don't go off how big the company is.
Yeah, that
will get you nowhere.
Trust okay.
me. So how long were you without a club then? Because obviously you said that summer your phone.
Oh, let me tell you. This is when the nightmare hit.
Okay.
Right. So I got let go from Charlton. Right. My phone wasn't calling at all.
Mm.
And then I got a phone call randomly from my old coach at Charlton, Mark Kinsella.
Mm.
He was like coaches at the time. He said, "Oh, do you fancy coming down, have a trial, if you like you?" I said, "Cool, I'll come down." I went down there, done really well, like really, really well.
Yeah.
They said, "Look, we like you, but we don't have the budget." I said, "I don't really care about the budget, I just want to sign."
Wow.
He said, "I love that, cool. All you got to do is play against, was playing West Ham the next day in a pre-season friendly.
Mm.
After the game, we'll sign you, run the contract, cool. You've done a practice game, 11-11 as you do to practice for the game the next day. Running back, I just felt my knee pop.
Oh my God.
I said, ooh. But before we even trained, my leg felt a bit funny. My knee felt funny.
Yeah.
Mm. And one of my boys, Anthony Cook, was like, just sit out. Just don't train. Just sit out. I said, I can't sit out. There's a game tomorrow. I need to make sure they know I'm ready.
Mm.
Sort of thing. So I just didn't think nothing of it. For the pop, I thought, this feels a bit funny. I literally tried to run off again. I fell over. I thought,
wow.
I couldn't even run. My knee just blew up. Like a balloon just blew up. Went to the side. Told the physio, he's like, we need a scan. Thinking, all right, I'm at a team that can help me with a scan.
Yeah.
I had to pay for my own scan.
Right.
Because someone was signed. Someone signed. Pay for my own scan. Pay for my scan, find out I need the operation.
Mm.
I was thinking, because they want to sign me, they obviously have me for rehab and whatnot. Mm. They just said to me, come back in January. I was like, what? What do you mean? Come back in January. Like, you're no use to us right now.
Wow.
Which is the reality of it.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And being a free agent,
yeah.
I have no income. Zero income. Wow. Nothing.
So this is what young people don't really think about. Because obviously one of your friends was telling you to sit out. And had you sat out that game or that training session,
yeah.
Things would have been a lot different. Does that go through your mind?
All the time. Every day. When I see football on TV, and I see my friends, like people like Joe Gomez, for example, in the Champions League, I played with him, exceptional player, but I could be still playing, like I'm still among it, like John Joe, look at Carl Jenkinson at Arsenal, my friend Chris Solly still playing, my friend Harry Pell still playing at Colchester. I look back and I think, my friends are still playing, man, I should still be playing with them, but that one decision kind of killed me.
Does watching football, taking part in football, become very distasteful for you to watch it and sit there and think?
I want to say it's distasteful. I miss it.
You miss it.
But at the same time, I do enjoy watching my friends enjoy playing football because I know what they're going through, where they're at. I'm proud.
Yeah.
It makes me happy seeing them playing and doing well.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So what I'll say is a distasteful, but I still love the game. I still watch it every day.
Mm.
But just knowing that I can't play, it's really, really hurtful.
How? And obviously not being able to play really does affect your mental health, especially if that's your...
It does.
That's what you want to do.
What support did you get, like, from anybody?
This is the thing. Mm. When I was in that dark place, I didn't really see many. Some would obviously show a bit of support, but to me it felt a bit half-hearted.
Mm.
You know what I'm saying? Maybe I could have spoke up more, but why should I speak up?
Mm.
People know that. How football meant to me.
But you know what? Everyone that knows Yado Mambo knows he's rarely down. You rarely see him down.
So therefore,
I feel like it's very hard. It's very hard. Like we talk about mental health in a way where it's like you should kind of see it. You should see the signs. But this is a sign of a happy man that was going through the worst moment in his life.
Yeah.
Mm. Like we were playing PlayStation online, bro. Do you know what I mean?
Mm.
Like. Yeah, we'll talk about it, but you say, I'm all right. Yeah, no, I'm good, it'll work out.
It was always the case of me being all right. I didn't want to let people see that I was down or vulnerable. So my career went from playing League One with Shrewsbury Town and the good loan, getting released from Charlton, to working in Waitrose in about 3 months.
So what stopped you from like kind of speaking to like your friends and family about how you really felt? Why didn't you want to be vulnerable?
I just didn't know. I just feel like I failed.
Yeah.
Because I've been that person that's always been, oh, that's he as a footballer.
Yeah. Mm. But the thing is that, I mean, I don't feel like you failed because you had the mind, you had the ability.
Mm.
It's just that your knee kind of gave up on you. If it didn't go wrong in that training session, it could have went on wrong.
That's true. I mean? But you know, that's the old cliche.
Yeah.
Oh, I could have made it, but
yeah.
My knees.
We've all seen that meme.
So how did you feel when you saw that meme then? Let's take it to you. Like, how did you feel?
I felt, bro, that some of us actually did go through that. You know what I mean?
Sorry, bad word. I
shouldn't
have said that.
But yeah, I was thinking, nah, man, I actually went through that.
Yeah.
But it was a tough time, man. I'd go home and cry, man.
Yeah.
Cry. Remember when I got told I'd be out for like 6-7 months, I cried, man, for time, thinking, bro, what am I going to do? People on my back. This is when the African parents come in. Go to uni. Do this, do that. I'm thinking, come on. I don't want to hear that right now.
Yeah.
All I want to hear is, listen, yeah, this is a blip that's going to happen. You'll get through it. You'll be fine. Mm. Go ahead. Cool. Yeah. But at the time, pressure was just on me. I had bills running up. I had a car that I had up, that nice car.
Yeah.
60S3.
I called it Amy. They came to my house. They came to my house.
Not like the one on Love Island, by the way.
Yeah, they came to my house and really they needed. Took her. They took her from me, bro. They picked her up, put her on a truck and they cut. I said, no way. This can't be happening. I cried that day as well. I thought, I love that car, you know.
I remember you called me that day.
I cried. I had a loan from the bank. I couldn't pay back. These man shut me off the account. Boom. You can't bank with us no more.
Wow.
All stuff like that. And then I had literally no money. So from playing football to reducing cheese in a fridge where it's cold.
Yeah.
Wow. What is this?
It's crazy.
What is
the high life.
So hear this. So I'm in the Rachel's in Greenwich, and that's by Charlton.
Right.
Charlton fans used to come in. I remember this one guy, right? This is when I actually walked out of Rachel's this day. I walked out and I can't believe it.
Yeah.
I was reducing cheese, right? This guy comes up to me. He's like, "Do I know you from somewhere? You're Yado Mambo, aren't you?"
Mm.
I was like, "Yeah." He goes, "What the F you doing here, mate?" He's not playing Charlton like 2 months ago. I was like, bro, like, I got injured, free agent, and I can't. I need money, so I need to work. That's a shame, isn't it? I was like, yeah. He goes, but you're here. Do you not go to another team or anything like that? Mm. He was so insensitive.
Mm. You didn't understand. You just told him I'm injured,
yeah, free agent. So insensitive. I was thinking, I had a vein popping up my head thinking, I'm going to attack this man right now.
Was he trying to defend himself? Or were
you
just
he was a Charlton fan. Mm.
But look, football
but
fans,
insensitive
be honest,
people.
They are.
It's some ruthless.
I'm not going to tweet about this. Yeah. I'm not going to take a picture and tweet or put on Instagram. I was just thinking, bro.
I will throw this cheese at you.
Your badge. Throw your badge on the ground.
Took off my apron. I said, no. This is long. Went to the back. I said, I can't do this.
Yeah.
I said, I can't do this. I really can't.
So, who's there for you during those hard times? Can you think of who actually sort of guided you through that dark time?
It's hard to even put a name on it.
Really?
It's hard to even put a name on it. Yeah. But the thing is, I don't blame my friends.
Yeah.
I don't blame them at all because that's just me, the whole facade that I put up. They thought it was okay.
Mm.
It's only when I broke it down to them, that's when they realised.
Yeah.
But obviously, talking to you, Eli, Kevin, about things, and obviously Shay knew, he was there, Kenneth.
Mm.
My parents were there to an extent, but I felt pressured by my parents just to get money somehow.
Mm.
Then they came, what I did, just get money somehow to survive, which made sense, though, in the same time. But at the same time, I want to hear, yeah, you got this, don't give up, go, go play.
Yeah.
You've been there, look at that shot on the wall.
Yeah.
Go, keep going.
You wanted that extra
oomph. I wanted that extra oomph. Mm. And I felt myself just laying in bed, no one to go anywhere, no one to do nothing. Just literally laying there thinking, nah, this is, I don't want
to
be here right now.
Did you have any coping mechanisms to sort of get out of your head?
Coping?
Yeah.
I was always the one, I can say I'm very strong mentally, if I'm honest. Look, I got good friends around me too, to be fair, but I'll always be out of the house. Well, try to get out of the house. It was hard to get out of the house. This is why I don't really share. I haven't really shared this part. There'll be times I wake up from sleep thinking, what am I doing?
Yeah.
What am I doing? Where do I go? What do I do? what job do I apply for? My CV is rubbish. I can't do nothing. I have no experience in this place. People will look past me because of my sports background. Because nowadays people want experience. Yes or no? Yes or no?
Yeah.
So it's just like, just that fear of knowing I don't know where I'm going to go, I don't know what I'm going to do. It's very, very scary and heartbreaking at the same time. Very heartbreaking. Honestly, I don't know how I coped, but I was near enough over the edge.
Yeah. So, you know, have you, like anyone in football, is there anyone that you know in football that has not come out of that darkness where they've been through that same situation as you and, you know, it's, you know, they've been stuck in that,
I've had a couple of friends that couldn't really get over the fact that they weren't playing football no more. But they've had to
go over it.
I always tell people nowadays when I see young footballers in the street or if I know someone, I say, listen, have a plan B. The plan B is vital, man. Like, try get like a little degree or something, or a little certificate or something. Yeah. Learn a trade on behind closed doors.
Yeah,
because you never know what can happen, man.
Yeah. But I mean, it's kind of difficult though. Because when people tell you like you have a future in this sport,
it's true.
Like, that's the only thing you kind of focus.
You get very tunnel vision. But I'm trying to break that cycle now where kids are just thinking about football. Yeah.
This is it.
No,
because I was watching. Sky Sports. Yeah, I was watching Sky Sports. And then they were talking about Dale Jennings. The guy that was at Bayern, signed to Bayern Munich, and at 26 years old, he's playing in the ninth league of football.
Mm.
And he was just talking about his now disdain for football, sort of thing, like just how the nightmare of it all started with an injury.
Yeah.
And then you start to free fall.
Football can collapse really quick. It's a ruthless game.
Mm.
Just like the music industry.
Mm.
If you're not feeling, people don't like you or you're not doing well, you're easily forgot about. Easily.
Would you say that's also due to politics within the game?
Politics can be part of it, but I don't think politics is why you decline so quickly.
Okay.
It's just about, and then you need luck as well at the same time. You need luck.
Mm.
But yeah, I can say yeah, politics can put others behind that as well, to be fair.
What do you think clubs can do to help the youth that are in that sort of uncertainty? They need, you know, that guidance, because I feel as if though, like, these stats are worrying, man. Like 700 youths under 16.
Yeah, it's very worrying. I feel that
get released. And there's no plan B, like you said.
I think clubs really, 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 really tell the kids need a plan B. Just install like a day class or a night class that they can go to that they can attend. Give them options that they can choose from to, you know what I'm saying, just in case nothing happens. Just in case.
But I get, sorry.
Go on. I was asking, but why do you think that clubs don't already instill these?
That's what I don't know.
I was gonna give a theory.
I honestly don't know.
I personally think it's because they want you to keep on pushing to the best of your ability.
That's what I was,
so if they give you, if they give you a plan B, then you may not be as focused on the football because you're thinking, hold on, there's a plan B here.
Yeah.
So, you know what, maybe if I do the plan B,
I'm clubs, not gonna... Clubs can't be selfish, man.
Mm. No, it's true,
They can't be selfish.
But all they're thinking about is their bottom line, really.
That's true. They need to get out of that mold because kids need to learn or be told. Even, not about having a plan B.
Mm.
Learn about finances. Learn about, I'm saying, proper. So you know, learn about buying a house. I don't think kids even know about buying houses. The whole method about buying houses.
But they put that onto their agent, don't they?
Yeah, I don't think agents should be the one to be doing it.
Yeah.
The club should be doing it.
Mm.
Educate the kids. Educate them.
I think if you take it back to when you first signed, back in like school, I feel like they should have done more at that point to make sure that you were doing your main curriculum.
Yeah.
So your English, your maths, your science. True. Make sure you're doing those.
Yeah. Obviously, you're like America.
Yeah, you're lucky.
So
exactly.
So in order to be part of our team, you need these grades.
If that was installed, that'd be even better.
Yeah.
Because they don't have that system in place over here. Swear.
No.
It's crazy.
Yeah. No, I don't think they're worried about your grades at all.
Because you're lucky. You're one of the lucky ones. 6 or 7. Not many other footballers, young footballers, even get close to that.
I feel they don't get because they don't care.
Yeah, no.
And they don't have to care because they know after school they're going to full time football.
Exactly.
But I think if your clubs now, listen, if you don't get these grades, you can't be part of the scholarship.
They need to.
Mm-hmm. That'd be better. I think they'd be more focused. They'd probably learn more.
Yeah.
And they'll know more. So if they don't get it, they can fall back on
something. Exactly. And also, it'll make them,
they don't have a plan B without even realizing they had a plan B.
There we go.
Well.
Yeah. There we go. Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. And that's what I think is key.
Yeah.
So, it'll empower them, man. It'll empower the youth as
so,
well.
So we fast forward, you know, let's say to Col- is it Colchester where you decided to retire? Was it at Colchester?
No, I got told to retire. It was Ebbsfleet.
Ebbsfleet?
Yeah.
Who that told you to retire? Was it your decision or was
nah,
it someone?
I got told by the surgeon that I had to retire because my knees were in a bad place.
So what happened? What? Let's talk about the events leading up to that point then.
I had my ACL done, my left knee, my MCL, my right knee, and I had some clear outs, and now I've got arthritis in both my knees.
Okay. So,
what causes these issues?
Just wear and tear, apparently. Okay. And now the impact going through my knees is really, really messing up my knees.
Really?
And the surgeon said to me, if I don't stop playing now, then I'll end up getting chronic knee pains and I'll be able to walk. Whoa. Like a Zimmer frame or something.
Yeah.
I don't want to hear all that, man.
Yeah.
But you went back to playing football?
I tried again because I had no option. I had no plan B.
Okay.
Yeah. I couldn't get a good job that I wanted, so I thought, full no chance to get a bit of money. Non-league, play some, get some games and play to get some money, but I was hurting myself at the same time.
It's true. I guess we've spoken about the dark side, okay? We've touched on to the dark side. Let's talk about sort of the lifestyle of a
footballer. Lifestyle, because I was reading Jermaine Pennant's autobiography.
Mm.
Man, he did some mild shit.
He's married to a porn star right now.
Porn star, and he was doing things with Ashley Cole.
These Monopoly
thing.
Yeah, but these brothers
did
are.
Did you get involved in that?
Nah. Do you know what? If I was earning their money, probably. But these men were the pinnacle earning the big bucks.
Yeah.
I was there, but the lifestyle was still just as good.
Yeah.
Honestly, like the parties we went to. Even the woman around you. Everything's different. The way you're treated.
Did you find women throwing themselves at you like,
oh. Yeah, if you're in a club, obviously you got a table and you know the girls are catting to get inside and sit out, come to the table, they know who you are.
Yeah.
They know what team you played for. Yeah. Girls are very, very interesting.
So you had a choice. It was like Chris Tucker and Rush Hour 2.
There's always a roster to choose from.
Jeez!
Like, but obviously I had a girlfriend at the time, so I didn't do none of those stuff.
Say nice.
You know what I'm saying? I was the good.
We have to put that disclaimer out there. We're good people.
Yeah. So, but what I've seen is just, it's a great lifestyle. It's one that I think you'll be lucky to experience.
Yeah.
You said, like, this is quite an interesting story. So you recently met up with Jonjo Shelvey and you went out to a club.
Yes.
And he was like, sorry guys, I've got this.
Yes.
And he bought out the bar.
Yes.
How did that make you feel? Because you guys are still tight. You guys are still
different. Yeah, he's still my homie.
Yeah, how did it make you feel when, you know, he bought out the bar?
Nothing, because that's how JD's always been. He's always been a very nice guy. He's not selfish. He's very generous.
Mm.
He used to tell the goalkeepers, all right, if I save my penalty, I'll give you £100.
Swear.
That's the sort of guy he was. Drive my car.
Get me in goal.
Drive my car. He took us goal karting. Right. Remember, it was all like 16. Took the whole team of obviously youth team boys that was with us. Yeah. Goal karting.
Wow.
He's that sort of guy.
Mm.
But that night when we went out, and then the balls will come in, then it was like just balls, balls, balls.
What were you crazy. Thinking at the time? Were you thinking, shit, I'm gonna have to?
I was thinking, holy shit. I was gonna go home. They was like, let's go. I said, I can't afford this.
I'm not putting up with this.
I said, yo, I go by the table. No, I'm not involved. I got to go. He's like, oh, no, I've got it. I made a phone call, everyone's coming. I said, say no more. I'm not gonna argue with you.
Yeah.
It's okay. I'm not gonna argue with you. Let's go. But it was good, man. Good night. Turned up, got drunk. It was good. But I got drunk. He didn't even drink. Obviously, he had the train next day, but everyone else drunk and got merry. It's good, man. Really. It's a lifestyle you guys have to experience, man. Even when I was at Ebbsfleet, we went to Dubai.
Wow.
2 years in a row for free.
Wow.
For free. Everything was just paid for. Flights. We got a daily allowance.
Jeez.
Every day.
Come on.
Daily allowance. It was amazing. I shared in my hotel. I had Steven Gerrard there and Ross Barkley over there.
Mm.
What?
That was nice. Yeah. That was surreal.
Yeah.
And the second time we went, you know Brighton,
yeah.
They won promotion to the Premier League. We won the Conference South, about 10 leagues below.
Yeah.
We had a better and bigger table than them in Dubai.
Yeah.
Because our chairman was so rich.
Okay.
So we had the best table in the... Do you know Club White, you know, the bigger one?
Yeah, Club White in Dubai.
We had shout that place. Out. Shout out Club White.
Good time.
Good time.
But But it was.
Jeez! It was good. It's not too late for me, is it yet?
It's not too
still
late.
Going.
It's never
still
too going. Late. It's never too late. I've seen you, Paul League.
So what would you say? What would you say are your future plans now? Like, what's next for Yado Mambo?
This is one I don't even know myself, to be honest.
Even if you can't be on the pitch, is there like parts of football that you would like to be involved in?
One thing I would like to do, I'd like to set up a scheme where I can go down to different clubs and talk to the kids.
Love that.
And just say, listen guys, I know you guys have all got that tunnel vision right now, but let's be realistic. Not everyone in this room is going to be a pro footballer.
Yeah.
That's just how it is. Just how life is. We need a plan B. Just think about something you'd like to do. Think of a trade, something you like doing. It could be media.
Yeah.
It could be a journalist. It could be anything.
For real.
You can make dresses in fashion.
Yeah.
Just think about it and just have that know-how in the back of your mind that this might not be for me.
Yeah.
So you know something to fall back on.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Look at unis you want to go to or something or college you'd like to attend.
Yeah.
But don't be too tunnel vision. That's what I want to get. Yeah. And I want to talk to clubs where they can obviously give more to the kids. Not only just football, but in terms of their lifestyle, in terms of their finances.
Yeah.
I mean, like I said, buying houses, leasing cars, they need to know what they're spending their money on because these kids nowadays are getting big money.
Yeah.
I'm talking like maybe 4K a week, 5K a week.
How do you manage that at that age? It's crazy.
It's much. It's overwhelming.
Yeah.
So they need to know how they're spending their money because sometimes footballers go broke real quick. Really quick. The money goes like that. So they need to learn to know where to invest their money. And how to invest and who to invest it with. I think the kids need to know, man. And that's my plan, to obviously help these clubs educate the kids a bit more.
Yeah.
So you heard it here first, guys. He's making big moves.
You heard it here.
One question from my student, actually, because I'm a PE teacher. He said, who was the best player you played with?
I played with?
Yeah. Or you played against? Best player.
Give us both, actually. Why not, innit?
Yeah.
Give us both.
And the worst.
And the worst.
He's going to probably say Kevin's the worst. Kevin's the worst at five side.
Played with. I'd probably say Jonjo.
Really?
Yeah.
Bruh.
He was special.
You know what? I remember you saying that when we came to watch that your FA Youth Cup match against Tottenham, I believe it was. And no word of a lie, I remember saying to him, like, yo, who's that bold guy? He's bossing that midfield.
He was unreal. From when I first joined the academy and I played with him, I thought, this guy is just incredible. Like, and then from making his first debut at 16, number 7 shirt at 16.
Wow.
Amazing. The stuff he was doing, even now, what he's achieved so far has been amazing. Playing for England. Bought by Swansea, Liverpool, Newcastle.
Come on, man.
The guy's rats is endless, bro. He's just amazing. Best player I played against, Jermaine Defoe. Hands down. He literally destroyed me. This is a funny story, actually. We're playing Spurs, and he's obviously come up for injury, so it's a reserve game, right? We lost, I think, like 8-0, I think, or 7-0. So he played 45 minutes, the first half, right? He scored 4 goals.
Yeah.
The first 3 goals, all deflection. I said to him, I go, it's Jermaine. Can you not score by deflection, bro? what's that about? Like, come on, man. I mean, it's like yesterday. So he gets the ball, right? Turns, bangs it, top bins. No deflection. He looks at me, he winks. He says, is that good enough for you? Actually, you know what? I couldn't say enough to you. Say well done. And he walked off, took his shirt off, he cut. I said, nah, he's gonna take the piss. Jeez. I said, nah. But even I played with Luka Modric.
Yeah.
That was an experience that I'll never forget in the reserve game.
When he was at Spurs,
He was at Spurs. William Gallas was there. Jeez. He was unreal. John Bostock at the time, Victor Moses.
Wow.
When they were coming through Palace, them two was a nightmare. Swear. Even Arsenal, like that Jack Wilshere, the Manuel Frimpongs, Sanchez Watts, Craig Eastmans, Szczesny in goal. They had a few good players, man. Our age, that era, players are playing now, Premier League, good players, man.
Yeah.
Great players. The worst, I won't say the worst, that's a bit harsh.
That's a bit harsh. No. Just say Kevin.
So, obviously, wind it down. We've got these pictures in front, obviously.
Oh, yeah. Are these good pictures?
Which ones stand out to you the most? Or which one stands out to you the most?
I love that one.
Which one is that? First,
no, you pick it up, show us.
So we know which. Okay.
This one here. This is my first league goal. What a feeling. What a feeling.
Where were you at that time?
This was Shrewsbury Town. Oh. So this is my first Football League goal, playing Carlisle United away.
Do you have that picture at home somewhere?
I do. This was March 18th, I believe.
Wow.
Everyone's the date. Yeah, so corner kick comes in. One of my boy, Connor Goldson, that plays Rangers right now, he has the ball down, keeper saves it, I'm there for the tap in. There we go, celebrate wildly.
Wow.
Good times, man. Wow. Great times.
Great times. Sorry, man. No, I'm saying, this picture here, can you explain that one?
Oh, this one here?
Yeah.
This was the FA Cup game against MK Dons. When we scored the equaliser, the noise, I've never experienced that in my life. It was unbelievable. Unbelievable. And they run onto the pitch, like, celebrate with us. It was unreal. And I even saw my dad run down. I saw my dad last time, like, look at you. this was a great day. Then this goal, I think, is probably the best celebration I've actually been a part of. Like, honestly, great goal.
Do you know what? Which one my favourite is? It's that one. You know the one they were causing a frenzy about, Yado number this, 5. It had nothing to do with you playing football.
This is your number 5 shirt.
This
is your last name's Mambo. This picture here, right?
Yeah.
This, we played later on the TV on BT Sports. Yeah. And obviously I had the number 18 shirt.
Yeah.
Someone tweeted, imagine number 5, but no, I haven't remembered, but name number 5 shirt.
Yeah.
I remember sharing that.
From them, it went viral.
I swear.
It went viral. I was getting phone calls. That got retweeted, I think, 150k times.
Wow.
An interview from ITV, BBC, radio interviews.
What?
The song, the guy that wrote the song.
Yeah.
Called me.
Yeah.
Yeah, he called me and said, I want to come sing it again. Would you sing with me? I said, it was a bit surreal. I said, really? You'd come down to Epsley to sing with me?
Just naming girls a little bit.
I said, why not? So, obviously, I turned into a good cause. I actually made a number 5 shirt and I made it for charity.
Yeah.
And I raised, I think, 50k, I think, for prostate cancer. Yeah.
Lovely.
Because our chairman had prostate cancer, so I thought it was a good cause to get some research and that. So that was a good cause.
Mm.
It was good, but that week or so, crazy. crazy.
Saw it everywhere. You see it everywhere.
Oh, look at this one. I like this one here, to be fair.
It's going through all of them now.
This one I love as well. Me and my little brother.
Talk us through that, man.
This was the first trophy I won since my injuries. So after coming back from all the nightmare I had, I joined FC, and we won the playoff, and that feeling was just unbelievable.
Yeah.
I felt relevant. It felt great.
Mm.
You know, like, to come back from knees. Knees are a big problem.
Knees are a big problem. No one wants to go near you.
No one wants to go near you. And to win the playoff with these boys was so great. Mm. One of the best things that I've ever had, honestly. Like, I thought, you know what, this is nice. I'm back where I used to be.
Mm.
The feeling felt great. Winning, had my family there, my friends.
Mm.
It was great.
Yeah. For real, man. Yeah, it's honestly, Yado Mambo. You got to say thank you. Massive thank you for coming out. Your story is very touching. And I hope it reaches out to, you know, the younger audience, you know,
I really hope the younger audience take time to listen to this, because I feel that the word needs to be spread.
Yeah, absolutely. So of all what's happened, like, what's the most important lesson that you've learned?
Yeah, what would be your message?
Yeah.
My lesson is, don't have that tunnel vision.
Mm.
Just have that plan B. I know I keep saying this, but have that plan B, man. I can't emphasize that a bit more.
Mm.
We need to educate the youth, man.
Mm.
Not just footballers, all athletes, different basketball players, they can be athletic runners. I mean, just have that plan B, because plan A does not always work.
Mm.
If it does work, kudos to you, but plan B needs to be there, because your life can change just like that, for the worst.
Yeah.
And I don't want people to go through what I went through,
being
silly and not knowing what plan B to use.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Learn from me. Mm-hmm. Trust me, learn from me. Don't be here. It's a dark, dark, dark place.
Mm-hmm.
And hopefully when I get this program started up, obviously going to teams and educating the youth, people learn a bit more, having more plan Bs. And maybe even universities can help.
Yeah,
it can approach clubs and listen, here's programs we can offer to your to your youth. Do you know what I mean? Something like that. So that's in the microwave, in the cooker.
Yeah.
So hopefully you can get that sorted. But messages, have a plan B, boys.
Come on.
Okay.
Brilliant.
Love that. You heard it here first, have a plan B. Yado Mambo on Freezer Social.
Been a pleasure.
Come on.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Brilliant.
Thank you.
And obviously after, we're going to be putting out little messages, And also websites that you can go on that can also help you with different things if you're suffering with mental health, for example. Or if you need someone to speak to, if you're going through an issue like this,
absolutely
reach out to Yado. I'm sure
reach out to me, man. Listen,
happy to help you.
Instagram, Mr. Yads.
Yeah,
you can tweet me. I'm always open to people. Mm-hmm. I always share my stories, and if you got any questions, anything you want to ask me, feel free, man.
Yeah.
I'm always there. Brilliant.
We'll put everything up on Freezer Social, Instagram, Twitter, Facebook.
Yeah. Email can be up there.
Email
as well. Give my phone number.
Jeez!
Trust me.
You're single now.
Luck up.
It's a wrap.
Safe.
Thank you, man.
Thank you, man.